Penguin Random House Canada presents Ultra-Processed People: Why We Can't Stop Eating Food That Isn't Food, by Chris Van Tulleken. Read for you by Dr. Chris Van Tulleken and Dr. Xand Van Tulleken.
Introduction. Every Wednesday afternoon in the laboratory where I used to work, we had an event called Journal Club. Now, the word club makes it sound more fun than it actually was. The ritual, practiced in labs around the world, worked like this. One member of the lab would present a recent publication from the scientific literature that they felt was relevant to our work, and the rest of us would tear it to pieces. And if the paper wasn't of sufficient quality, then the unhappy person who'd selected it would also be torn to pieces. The lab, which is run by Greg Towers, is still based at University College London, in a converted Victorian hospital built by the same architect who designed the Natural History Museum. It's a beautiful old building, full of mice and leeks. And it seemed like an improbable venue for the world-class molecular virology research it produced when I arrived in 2011 to do a PhD. At these journal clubs, Greg and the other senior lab members taught me that science is not a list of rules or facts, but a living argument. Greg was more up for that argument about any data point in any paper than anyone I've met before or since. Nothing went unexamined. It was the best scientific training I could have hoped for. Now, the lab specialty was the ongoing competition between viruses like HIV and the cells they need to infect in order to reproduce. This competition is like a military arms race. All cells have defenses against viral attack, and all viruses carry weapons to overcome those defenses. Now, as the cells evolve ever more sophisticated defenses, so the viruses constantly evolve more sophisticated weapons, which in turn drives the evolution of even more sophisticated defenses in the cells, and so on. Now, most of us studied HIV and its viral cousins for exciting reasons, like the development of new drugs and vaccines. But there was a splinter group in the lab that studied a different type of virus, one that barely seemed like a virus at all. Almost half of the DNA in every cell in your body is made of ancient dead virus genes. Known for a long time as junk DNA, this topic seemed to be a scientific backwater until, in October 2014, one of the members of the splinter group presented a paper at Journal Club. It was from the publication Nature, and the title was dense with jargon. An evolutionary arms race between crab zinc finger genes ZNF91/93 and SVAL1 retrotransposons. I gave the paper a quick skim before the meeting and found it incomprehensible. Out of every 10 papers presented at Journal Club, roughly 7 would be demolished, 2 would stand up and provide useful new information, and 1 would betray evidence of naked fraud. It wasn't clear to me which category this paper would fall into. As we talked through the paper, I noticed a shift in the atmosphere. Everyone sat forward as the data made the case that these old dead viruses found throughout the human genome aren't dead at all. They have functioning genes ready to make more viruses. Every cell in your body is a potential virus factory, but something is keeping these viral genes quiet. It turned out that they're suppressed by other genes in the cell. The paper was saying that one part of our genome is constantly at war with another part. The implications of this were immediately obvious to everyone in a lab that was familiar with the nature of arms races. Whether they involve competition between viruses, neighborhood disputes, sports teams, political campaigns, or global superpowers, all arms races must generate complexity. As insurgency develops, so must counterinsurgency. Intelligence begets counterintelligence with double and triple agents. It's the development of ever more sophisticated weapons that drives the evolution of ever more sophisticated defenses. Because the human genome is in this internal arms race, with one piece of DNA at war with another, this means that it must inexorably be driven towards ever greater complexity. Over thousands of generations, as those old, supposedly dead viruses evolve, so the rest of the genome must evolve to keep them quiet. This arms race within our genes has been going on since the dawn of life, and it may very well be the engine of the evolution of complexity itself. The major difference between the human genome and that of chimpanzees is not in the parts that code for proteins, which are around 96% similar, but in the parts that seem to come from these old, supposedly dead viruses. This paper transformed my understanding of myself, even if it took me a while to get my head around the idea that, at least in part, I'm an assembly of old viruses at war with my other genes. And it may change the way you see yourself too. You aren't simply living alongside this arms race between different genes. You're the product of it, an uneasy coalition of competing genetic elements. These coalitions and competitions extend beyond our genes. Where you end and not you begins is far from clear. You're covered in microbes that keep you alive. They're a part of you as much as your liver is. But those same microbes can kill you if they get into the wrong area of the body. Our bodies are much more like societies than mechanical entities, comprising billions of bacteria, viruses, and other microbial life forms, but just one primate. They're full of odd, negotiated compromises and imperfections. Arms races blur boundaries. I worked in Greg's lab for 6 years before going back to being a doctor. But the idea of arms races and the complex systems they create and the boundaries they blur became a key part of the way I think about the world. I continued to do research, but my focus has shifted from studying viruses towards investigating scientific research that is biased or fraudulent. Now I mainly study the food industry and how it affects human health. My laboratory grounding has proved crucial for this. Arms races and their effects will come up a lot throughout this audiobook. For a start, to eat is to compete in an arms race that has lasted billions of years. The world around us has a relatively fixed amount of available energy, and all life is engaged in a competition against other forms of life for that energy. Life has, after all, only two projects: reproduction and extracting energy to fuel that reproduction. Predators are locked in competition, not only with each other to obtain prey, but also, of course, with the prey itself, which generally wants to hang on to the energy contained in its meat. The prey animals also compete for vegetation, both with each other and with the plants themselves, which produce toxins, thorns, and other defenses against being eaten. Plants compete with each other for sun, water, and soil. And microbes, bacteria, viruses, and fungi constantly assault all the organisms in the ecosystem to extract what energy they can. And no one gets ahead for long in an arms race. Wolves may be well adapted for eating deer, but deer are superbly adapted to avoid being eaten by wolves and do, on occasion, kill them. In fact, there's a significant scientific literature on wolves being killed by their prey. In one analysis, 40% of wolf skulls have evidence of injuries from prey, and wolves are well documented to have been killed by moose, musk oxen, and deer. We eat then as part of a set of interlinking, entangled arms races, competing for energy flowing between life forms. Like all arms races, this competition has generated complexity, and so everything about eating is complex. Our senses of taste and smell, our immune system, our manual dexterity, our tooth and jaw anatomy, our eyesight. It's hard to think of any aspect of human biology, physiology, or culture that isn't primarily shaped by our historic need for energy. Over billions of years, our bodies have superbly adapted to using a wide range of food. But over the past 150 years, food has become not food. We've started eating substances constructed from novel molecules and using processes never previously encountered in our evolutionary history, substances that can't really even be called food. Our calories increasingly come from modified starches, from invert sugars, hydrolyzed protein isolates, and seed oils that have been refined, bleached, deodorized, hydrogenated, and interesterified. And these calories have been assembled into concoctions using other molecules that our senses have never been exposed to either. Synthetic emulsifiers, low-calorie sweeteners, stabilizing gums, humectants, flavor compounds, dyes, color stabilizers, carbonating agents, firming agents, and bulking and anti-bulking agents. These substances entered the diet gradually at first, beginning in the last part of the 19th century. But the incursion gained pace from the 1950s onwards, to the point that they now constitute the majority of what people eat in the UK and the USA, and they form a significant part of the diet of nearly every society on Earth. And at the same time as we've entered this unfamiliar food environment, we've also moved into a new parallel ecosystem.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.